Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box. Affordable, mind-enriching programs.
Gildan Media presents 50 Great Myths of Popular Psychology, Shattering Widespread Misconceptions About Human Behavior, by Scott O. Lilienfeld, Stephen J. Lynn, John Ruscio, and Barry L. Beyerstein, narrated by Walter Dixon. Science must begin with myths and with the criticism of myths. Sir Karl Popper, 1957. Preface. Psychology is all around us. Youth and old age, forgetting and remembering, sleeping and dreaming, love and hate, happiness and sadness, mental illness and psychotherapy, for good, bad, and often both. This is the stuff of our daily lives. Virtually every day, the news media, television shows and films, and the internet bombard us with claims regarding a host of psychological topics: brain functioning, physics, out-of-body experiences, recovered memories, polygraph testing, romantic relationships, parenting, child sexual abuse, mental disorders, real crime, and psychotherapy, to name merely a few. Even a casual stroll through our neighborhood bookstore reveals at least dozens, and often hundreds, of self-help, relationship, recovery, and addiction books that serve up generous portions of advice for steering our path along life's rocky road. Of course, for those who prefer their psychological advice for free, there's no end of it on the web. In countless ways, the popular psychology industry shapes the landscape of the early 21st century world. Yet, to a surprising extent, much of what we believe to be true about psychology isn't. Although scores of popular psychology sources are readily available in bookstores and at our fingertips online, they're rife with myths and misconceptions. Indeed, in today's fast-paced world of information overload, misinformation about psychology is at least as widespread as accurate information. Unfortunately, precious few books are available to assist us with the challenging task of distinguishing fact from fiction in popular psychology. As a consequence, we often find ourselves at the mercy of self-help gurus, television talk show hosts, and radio self-proclaimed mental health experts, many of whom dispense psychological advice that's a confusing mix of truths, half-truths, and outright falsehoods. Without a dependable tour guide for sorting out psychological myth from reality, we're at risk for becoming lost in a jungle of misconceptions. Many of the great myths of popular psychology not only mislead us about human nature, but can also lead us to make unwise decisions in our everyday lives. Those of us who believe erroneously that people typically repress the memories of painful experiences, myth number 13, may spend much of our lives in a fruitless attempt to dredge up memories of childhood traumatic events that never happened. Those of us who believe that happiness is determined mostly by our external circumstances, myth 24, may focus exclusively outside rather than inside of ourselves to find the perfect formula for long-term satisfaction. And those of us who believe erroneously that opposites attract in romantic relationships, myth 27, may spend years searching for a soulmate whose personalities and values differ sharply from ours, only to discover too late that such matches seldom work well. Myths matter. As science educator David Hammer, 1996, noted, scientific misconceptions possess four major properties. They, 1, are stable and often strongly held beliefs about the world. 2, are contradicted by well-established evidence. 3, influence how people understand the world, and 4, must be corrected to achieve accurate knowledge. Stover and Saunders, 2000. For our purposes, the last point is especially crucial. In our view, mythbusting should be an essential component of psychology education, because deeply entrenched beliefs and psychological misconceptions can impede students' understanding of human nature. There are numerous dictionary definitions of the word myth, but the ones that best suit our purposes derive from the American Heritage Dictionary, 2000. A popular but false belief or story that has become associated with a person, institution, or occurrence. Or, a fiction or half-truth, especially one that forms part of an ideology. most of the myths we present in this audiobook are widely held beliefs that blatantly contradict psychological research. Others are exaggerations or distortions of claims that contain a kernel of truth. Either way, most of the myths we address in this audiobook can seem so compelling because they fit into a broader view of human nature that many people find plausible. For example, the false belief that we use only 10% of our brain power, myth number one, dovetails with the belief that many of us haven't fully realized our intellectual potential. And the false belief that low self-esteem is a major cause of maladjustment, myth number 33, fits with the belief that we can achieve just about anything if we believe in ourselves. Many psychological myths are also understandable efforts to make sense out of our worlds. As German sociologist and philosopher of science Klaus Mannhardt, 2005, observed, throughout history, myths have served a central function, attempting to explain the otherwise inexplicable. Indeed, many of the myths we discuss in this audiobook, like the belief that dreams have been shown to possess symbolic meaning, myth number 20, are efforts to grapple with some of life's perennial mysteries, in this case, the underlying significance of our nighttime mental worlds. Our audiobook is the first to survey the full landscape of modern popular psychology and to place common psychological misconceptions under the microscope of scientific evidence. By doing so, we hope to both dispel prevalent but false beliefs and arm listeners with accurate knowledge that they can use to make better real-world decisions. Our tone is informal, engaging, and at times irreverent. We've made particular efforts to make our audiobook accessible to beginning students and laypersons, and we presume no formal knowledge of psychology. To do so, we've kept technical language to a minimum. As a consequence, this audiobook can be enjoyed equally by specialists and non-specialists alike. We begin the audiobook by surveying the vast world of popular psychology, the dangers posed by psychological myths, and 10 major sources of these myths. Then, in the body of the book, we examine 50 widespread myths of popular psychology. For each myth, we discuss its prevalence in the general population, illustrative examples from the wide world of popular psychology, its potential origins, and the research evidence bearing on it. Although one of our main goals is mythbusting, we go well beyond merely debunking myths. For each myth, we also discuss what we know to be true regarding each topic, thereby imparting genuine psychological knowledge that listeners can take with them and apply to their everyday lives. Several of the 50 myths are accompanied by brief Mythbusting, A Closer Look features that examine a closely allied myth. Each chapter concludes with a set of other myths to explore, 250 in all, along with helpful suggested references for tracking down these myths. Instructors in psychology classes may find many of these additional myths handy as presentation or term paper topics to assign to their students. To drive home the point that psychological truth is often just as fascinating, if not more, than psychological myth, the book's postscript features a David Letterman-style top 10 list of remarkable psychological findings that may seem like myths, but that are in fact true. Finally, this audiobook also comes with an appendix available in a companion PDF to the audio program, which contains recommended internet resources for exploring various psychological myths. This audiobook, we believe, will appeal to several audiences: students in introductory psychology and research methods courses, as well as teachers of these courses, will find the audio program to be of particular interest. Many students enter these courses with misconceptions concerning a host of psychological topics, so confronting these misconceptions is often an essential step toward imparting accurate knowledge. Because we've organized the audiobook around 11 domains traditionally covered in introductory psychology courses, such as brain functioning and perception, memory, learning and intelligence, emotion and motivation, social psychology, personality, psychopathology, and psychotherapy, this audiobook can serve as either a freestanding resource or a supplement for these courses. Instructors who use this audiobook along with a standard introductory psychology textbook can easily assign some or all of the myths in each chapter in conjunction with the accompanying chapter in their textbook. Laypersons interested in learning more about psychology will find the audiobook to be an invaluable and user-friendly resource, as well as an entertaining compendium of psychological knowledge. Practicing psychologists and other mental health professionals, such as psychiatrists, psychiatric nurses, counselors, and social workers, psychology educators, psychological researchers, psychology majors, and psychology graduate students should also find the audiobook to be an enjoyable listen, not to mention a valuable reference source. Finally, we modestly believe that this audiobook should be recommended, dare we say required, reading for all journalists, writers, educators, and attorneys whose work touches on psychological topics. This audiobook should prevent them from falling prey to precisely the kinds of psychological misunderstandings against which we so vigorously caution our listeners. This project could never have come to fruition without the assistance of several talented and dedicated individuals. First and foremost, we sincerely thank our editor at Wiley Blackwell, Christine Cardoni, about whom we cannot say enough good things. Chris has provided invaluable guidance throughout this project, and we're deeply indebted to her for her support and encouragement. We consider ourselves remarkably fortunate to have worked with someone as competent, kind, and patient as Chris. Second, we thank Sean O'Hagan for his gracious assistance with the references section and help with the aging myth, Allison Cole for help with the midlife crisis myth, Otto Wall for help with the schizophrenia myth, and Fern Pratikin Lynn, Ailet Marin Ruscio, and Susan Himes for their useful suggestions on miscellaneous myths. Third, we thank Constance Adler, Hannah Rolls, and Annette Abel at Wiley Blackwell for their editorial assistance and copy editing. Fourth, we thank the following reviewers of drafts of the book prospectus in various chapters, whose comments, suggestions, and constructive criticisms were extraordinarily helpful to us in improving our early drafts. We are especially indebted to the following reviewers for their wise counsel: David R. Barkmeyer, Northeastern University; Barney Baines, Ithaca College; John Bickford, University of Massachusetts Amherst; Stephen F. Davis, Morningside College; Sergio de la Sala, University of Edinburgh; Dana Dunn, Moravian College; Brandon Gaudiano, Brown University; Eric Landrum, Boise State University; Depp Lowe, University of the Free State; Loretto Prieto, Iowa State University; Jeff Ricker, Scottsdale Community College; and the numerous instructors who took our initial survey. We're honored to dedicate this audiobook to the memory of our dear friend, colleague, and co-author Barry Beyerstein. Although his contribution to this volume was cut short by his untimely death in 2007 at the age of 60, the manuscript bears the imprint of his keen mind and ability to communicate complex ideas to a wide audience. We know Barry would be extremely proud of this volume, which embodies his mission of educating the public about the promise of scientific psychology to increase our knowledge about what it means to be human and about the pitfalls of pseudoscience. We fondly remember Barry Beyerstein's passion for life and compassion for others, and dedicate this audiobook to him to commemorate his enduring legacy to the popularization of scientific psychology. As authors, we very much hope you enjoy hearing this audiobook as much as we enjoyed writing it. We welcome your feedback on the audiobook, not to mention suggestions for additional myths to discuss in future editions. May the mythbusting begin. Introduction. The Wide World of Psychomythology. Opposites attract. Spare the rod, spoil the child. Familiarity breeds contempt. There's safety in numbers. You've probably heard these four proverbs many times before. Moreover, like our rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, you probably hold them to be self-evident. Our teachers and parents have assured us that these sayings are correct, and our intuitions and life experiences confirm their wisdom. Yet psychological research demonstrates that all four proverbs, as people commonly understand them, are mostly or entirely wrong. Opposites don't attract in romantic relationships. To the contrary, we tend to be most attracted to people who are similar to us in our personalities, attitudes, and values. Myth 27. Sparing the rod doesn't necessarily spoil children. Moreover, physical punishment often fails to produce positive effects on their behavior. Familiarity usually breeds comfort, not contempt. We usually prefer things we've seen many times to things that are novel. Finally, there's typically danger rather than safety in numbers. Myth 28. We're more likely to be rescued in an emergency if only one bystander rather than a large group of bystanders is watching. The popular psychology industry. You've almost certainly learned a host of other facts from the popular psychology industry. This industry encompasses a sprawling network of sources of everyday information about human behavior, including television shows, radio call-in programs, Hollywood movies, self-help books, newsstand magazines, newspaper tabloids, and internet sites. For example, the popular psychology industry tells us that we only use 10% of our brain power. Our memories work like videotapes or tape recorders. If we're angry, it's better to express the anger directly than hold it in. Most sexually abused children grow up to become abusers themselves. People with schizophrenia have split personalities. People tend to act strangely during full moons. Yet, we'll learn in this audiobook that all six facts are actually fictions. Although the popular psychology industry can be an invaluable resource for information about human behavior, it contains at least as much misinformation as information. We term this vast body of misinformation psychomythology because it consists of misconceptions, urban legends, and old wives' tales regarding psychology. Surprisingly, few popular books devote more than a handful of pages to debunking psychomythology. Nor do more than a handful of popular sources provide readers with scientific thinking tools for distinguishing factual from fictional claims in popular psychology. As a consequence, many people, even students who graduate from college with majors in psychology, know a fair amount about what's true regarding human behavior, but not much about what's false. Before going much further, we should offer a few words of reassurance. If you believe that all of the myths we presented were true, there's no reason to feel ashamed, because you're in awfully good company. Surveys reveal that many or most people in the general population, as well as beginning psychology students, believe these and other psychological myths. Even some psychology professors believe them. If you're still feeling a bit insecure about your psychology IQ, you should know that the Greek philosopher Aristotle, 384 to 322 BC, who's widely regarded as one of the smartest human beings ever to walk the face of the earth, believed that emotions originate from the heart, not the brain, and that women are less intelligent than men. He even believed that women had fewer teeth than men. Aristotle's bloopers remind us that high intelligence offers no immunity against belief in psychomythology. Indeed, a central theme of this audiobook is that we can all fall prey to erroneous psychological claims unless we're armed with accurate knowledge. That's as true today as it was in past centuries. Indeed, for much of the 1800s, the psychological discipline of phrenology was all the rage throughout much of Europe and America. Phrenologists believed that extremely specific psychological capacities like poetic ability, love of children, appreciation of colors, and religiosity were localized to distinct brain regions, and they could detect people's personality traits by measuring the patterns of bumps on people's skulls. They thought incorrectly that enlarged brain areas create indentations on the skull. The range of psychological capacities supposedly pinpointed by phrenologists ranged from 27 to 43. Phrenology parlors, allowing curious patrons to have their skulls and personalities measured, sprouted up in many locations, giving rise to the still popular phrase, having one's head examined. Yet, phrenology turned out to be a striking example of psychomythology on a grand societal scale, as studies eventually showed that damage to the brain areas identified by phrenologists hardly ever caused the psychological deficits they'd so confidently predicted. Although phrenology, depicted on the cover of the print version of this audiobook, is now dead, scores of other examples of psychomythology are alive and well. In this audiobook, we'll help you distinguish fact from fiction in popular psychology and provide you with a set of myth-busting skills for evaluating psychological claims scientifically. We'll not only shatter widespread myths about popular psychology, but explain what's been found to be true in each domain of knowledge. We hope to persuade you that scientifically supported claims regarding human behavior are every bit as interesting as, and often even more surprising than, the mistaken claims. That's not to say that we should dismiss everything the popular psychology industry tells us. Many self-help books encourage us to take responsibility for our mistakes rather than to blame others for them. Offer a warm and nurturing environment for our children. Eat in moderation and exercise regularly. And rely on friends and other sources of social support when we're feeling down. By and large, these are wise tidbits of advice, even if our grandmothers knew about them. The problem is that the popular psychology industry often intersperses such advice with suggestions that fly in the face of scientific evidence. For example, some popular talk show psychologists urge us to always follow our heart in romantic relationships, even though this advice can lead us to make poor interpersonal decisions. The popular television psychologist, Dr. Phil McGraw, Dr. Phil, has promoted the polygraph, or so-called lie detector test, on his television program as a means of finding out which partner in a relationship is lying. Yet, as we'll learn later in Myth 23, scientific research demonstrates that the polygraph test is anything but an infallible detector of the truth. Armchair psychology. As personality theorist George Kelly pointed out in 1955, we're all armchair psychologists. We continually seek to understand what makes our friends, family members, lovers, and strangers tick, and we strive to understand why they do what they do. Moreover, psychology is an inescapable part of our everyday lives. Whether it's our romantic relationships, friendships, memory lapses, emotional outbursts, sleep problems, performance on tests, or adjustment difficulties, psychology is all around us. The popular press bombards us on an almost daily basis with claims regarding brain development, parenting, education, sexuality, intelligence testing, memory, crime, drug use, mental disorders, psychotherapy, and a bewildering array of other topics. In most cases, we're forced to accept these claims on faith alone because we haven't acquired the scientific thinking skills to evaluate them. As neuroscience mythbuster Sergio Della Sala, 1999, reminded us, "Believers' books abound, and they sell like hotcakes." Page 14. That's a shame, because although some popular psychology claims are well supported, scores of others aren't. Indeed, much of everyday psychology consists of what psychologist Paul Meehl called in 1993 fireside inductions, assumptions about behavior based solely on our intuitions. The history of psychology teaches us one undeniable fact. Although our intuitions can be immensely useful for generating hypotheses to be tested using rigorous research methods, they're often woefully flawed as a means of determining whether these hypotheses are correct. To a large extent, that's probably because the human brain evolved to understand the world around it, not to understand itself, a dilemma that science writer Jacob Bronowski in 1966 called reflexivity. Making matters worse, we often cook up reasonable-sounding but false explanations for our behaviors after the fact. As a consequence, we persuade ourselves that we understand the causes of our behaviors, even when we don't. Psychological science and common sense. One reason we're easily seduced by psychomythology is that it jibes with our common sense, our gut hunches, intuitions, and first impressions. Indeed, you may have heard that most psychology is just common sense. Many prominent authorities agree, urging us to trust our common sense when it comes to evaluating claims. Popular radio talk show host Dennis Prager is fond of informing his listeners that there are two kinds of studies in the world, those that confirm our common sense and those that are wrong. Prager's views regarding common sense are probably shared by many members of the general public. Use your common sense. Whenever you've heard the words studies show outside of the natural sciences, and you find that these studies show the opposite of what common sense suggests, be very skeptical. I do not recall ever coming across a valid study that contravened common sense. Prager, 2002, page 1. For centuries, many prominent philosophers, scientists, and science writers have urged us to trust our common sense. Fernum, 1996, Gendreau, Goggin, Cullen, and Paparazzi, 2002. The 18th-century Scottish philosopher Thomas Reid argued that we're all born with common-sense intuitions, and that these intuitions are the best means of arriving at fundamental truths about the world. More recently, in a New York Times editorial, well-known science writer John Horgan, 2005, called for a return to common sense in the evaluation of scientific theories, including those in psychology. For Horgan, far too many theories in physics and other areas of modern science contradict common sense, a trend he finds deeply worrisome. In addition, the last several years have witnessed a proliferation of popular and even best-selling books that champion the power of intuition and snap judgments. Most of these books acknowledge the limitations of common sense in evaluating the truth of scientific claims, but contend that psychologists have traditionally underestimated the accuracy of our hunches. Yet, as the French writer Voltaire in 1764 pointed out, common sense is not so common. Contrary to Dennis Prager, psychological studies that overturn our common sense are sometimes right. Indeed, one of our primary goals in this audiobook is to encourage you to mistrust your common sense when evaluating psychological claims. As a general rule, you should consult research evidence, not your intuitions, when deciding whether a scientific claim is correct. Research suggests that snap judgments are often helpful in sizing up people and in forecasting our likes and dislikes, but they can be wildly inaccurate when it comes to gauging the accuracy of psychological theories or assertions. We'll soon hear why. As several science writers, including Lewis Wolpert and Alan Cromer, have observed, science is uncommon sense. In other words, science requires us to put aside our common sense when evaluating evidence. To understand science, including psychological science, we must heed the advice of the great American humorist Mark Twain, namely that we need to unlearn old habits of thinking at least as much as learn new ones. In particular, we need to unlearn a tendency that comes naturally to all of us, the tendency to assume that our gut hunches are correct. Of course, not all popular psychology wisdom, sometimes called folk psychology, is wrong. Most people believe that happy employees get more work done on the job than unhappy employees, and psychological research demonstrates that they're right. Yet time and time again, scientists, including psychological scientists, have discovered that we can't always trust our common sense. In part, that's because our raw perceptions can deceive us. For example, for many centuries, humans assumed not only that the Earth is flat, after all, it sure seems flat when we're walking on it, but that the sun revolves around the Earth. This latter fact in particular seemed obvious to virtually everyone. After all, each day the sun paints a huge arc across the sky while we remain planted firmly on the ground. But in this case, observers' eyes fooled them. As science historian Daniel Beyerstein noted in 1983, nothing could be more obvious than that the Earth is stable and unmoving and that we are the center of the universe. Modern Western science takes its beginning from the denial of this common sense axiom. Common sense, the foundation of everyday life, could no longer serve for the governance of the world. As science historian Daniel Beyerstein, 1983, noted, nothing could be more obvious than that the Earth is stable and unmoving and that we are the center of the universe. Modern Western science takes its beginning from the denial of this common sense axiom. Common sense, the foundation of everyday life, could no longer serve for the governance of the world. Page 294. Let's consider another example. Michael McCloskey in 1983 asked students to predict the path of a ball that has just exited from an enclosed spiral. About half of the undergraduates predicted incorrectly that the ball would continue to travel in a spiral path after exiting. In fact, the ball will travel in a straight path after exiting. These students typically invoked common sense notions like momentum when justifying their answers. For example, the ball started traveling in a certain way, so it will just keep going that way. By doing so, they seemed almost to treat the ball as a person, much like a figure skater who starts spinning on the ice and keeps on spinning. In this case, their intuitions betrayed them. We can see another delightful example in the so-called Shepherd's Tables. You can find them online by Googling Shepherd's Tables and looking at the images. They were created by cognitive psychologist Roger Shepherd in 1990. If you take a careful look at the two tables and ask yourself which tabletop contains a larger surface area, the answer seems obvious at first glance. Yet, believe it or not, the surfaces of both tables are identical. Just as we shouldn't always trust our eyes, we shouldn't always trust our intuitions. The bottom line, seeing is believing, but seeing isn't always believing correctly. Shepherd's tables provide us with a powerful optical illusion, an image that tricks our visual system. In the remainder of this audiobook, though, we'll be crossing paths with a variety of cognitive illusions, beliefs that trick our reasoning process. We can think of many or most psychological myths as cognitive illusions because, like visual illusions, they can fool us. Why should we care? Why is it important to know about psychological myths? There are at least three reasons. 1. Psychological myths can be harmful. For example, jurors who believe incorrectly that memory operates like a videotape may vote to convict a defendant on the basis of confidently held but inaccurate eyewitness testimony, as we'll hear in myth number 11. In addition, parents who believe incorrectly that punishment is usually an effective means of changing long-term behavior may spank their children whenever they misbehave, only to find that their children's undesirable actions become more frequent over time. 2. Psychological myths can cause indirect damage. Even false beliefs that are themselves harmless can inflict significant indirect harm. Economists use the term opportunity cost to refer to the fact that people who seek out ineffective treatments may forfeit the chance to obtain much-needed help. For example, people who believe mistakenly that subliminal self-help tapes are an effective means to losing weight may invest a good deal of time, money, and effort on a useless intervention, as we'll hear in myth number 5. They may also miss out on scientifically based weight loss programs that could prove beneficial. 3. The acceptance of psychological myths can impede our critical thinking in other areas. As astronomer Carl Sagan noted in 1995, our failure to distinguish myth from reality in one domain of scientific knowledge, such as psychology, can easily spill over to a failure to distinguish fact from fiction in other vitally important areas of modern society. These domains include genetic engineering, stem cell research, global warming, pollution, crime prevention, schooling, daycare, and overpopulation, to name only a few. As a consequence, we may find ourselves at the mercy of policymakers who make unwise and even dangerous decisions about science and technology. As Sir Francis Bacon reminded us, knowledge is power. Ignorance is powerlessness. The 10 sources of psychological myths. Your myth-busting kit. How do psychological myths and misconceptions arise? We'll try to persuade you that there are 10 major ways in which we can be fooled by plausible-sounding but false psychological claims. It's essential to understand that we're all vulnerable to these 10 sources of error, and that we're all fooled by them from time to time. Learning to think scientifically requires us to become aware of these sources of error and learn to compensate for them. Good scientists are just as prone to these sources of error as the average person, but good scientists have adopted a set of safeguards called the scientific method for protecting themselves against them. The scientific method is a toolbox of skills designed to prevent scientists from fooling themselves. If you become aware of the 10 major sources of psychomythology, you'll be far less likely to fall into the trap of accepting erroneous claims regarding human nature. Pay careful attention to these 10 sources of error because we'll come back to them periodically throughout the audiobook. In addition, you'll be able to use these sources of error to evaluate a host of folk psychology claims in your everyday life. Think of them as your lifelong myth-busting kit. 1. Word of mouth. Many incorrect folk psychology beliefs are spread across multiple generations by verbal communication. For example, because the phrase "opposites attract" is catchy and easily remembered, people tend to pass it on to others. Many urban legends work the same way. For example, you might have heard the story about alligators living in the New York City sewer system, or about the well-intentioned but foolish woman who placed her wet poodle in a microwave to dry it off, only to have it explode. For many years, the first author of this audiobook relayed a story he'd heard many times, namely the tale of a woman who purchased what she believed was a pet chihuahua, only to be informed weeks later by a veterinarian that it was actually a gigantic rat. Although these stories make for juicy dinner table conversation, they're no truer than any of the psychological myths we'll present in this audiobook. The fact that we've heard a claim repeated over and over again doesn't make it correct, but it can lead us to accept this claim as correct even when it's not, because we can confuse a statement's familiarity with its accuracy. Advertisers who tell us repeatedly that 7 of 8 dentists surveyed recommend Bright Shine toothpaste above all other brands capitalize on this principle mercilessly. Furthermore, research shows that hearing one person express an opinion, "Joe Smith is the best qualified person to be president," 10 times can lead us to assume that this opinion is as widely held as hearing 10 people express this opinion once. Hearing is often believing, especially when we hear a statement over and over again. 2. Desire for easy answers and quick fixes. Let's face it, everyday life isn't easy, even for the best adjusted of us. Many of us struggle to find ways to lose weight, get enough sleep, perform well in exams, enjoy our jobs, and find a lifelong romantic partner. It's hardly a surprise that we glom onto techniques that offer foolproof promises of rapid, painless behavior changes. For example, fad diets are immensely popular, even though research demonstrates that the substantial majority of people who go on them regain all of their weight within just a few years. Equally popular are speed reading courses, many of which promise to increase people's reading speeds from a mere 100 or 200 words per minute to 10,000 or even 25,000 words per minute. Yet researchers have found that none of these courses boost people's reading speeds without decreasing their reading comprehension. What's more, most of the reading speeds advertised by these courses exceed the maximum reading speed of the human eyeball, which is about 300 words per minute. A word to the wise? If something sounds too good to be true, it probably is. 3. Selective perception and memory. As we've already discovered, we rarely, if ever, perceive reality exactly as it is. We see it through our own set of distorting lenses. These lenses are warped by our biases and expectations, which lead us to interpret the world in accord with our pre-existing beliefs. Yet most of us are blissfully unaware of how these beliefs influence our perceptions. Psychologist Lee Ross and others have termed the mistaken assumption that we see the world precisely as it is as naive realism. Naive realism not only leaves us vulnerable to psychological myths, but renders us less capable of recognizing them as myths in the first place. A striking example of selective perception and memory is our tendency to focus on hits, memorable co-occurrences, rather than on misses, the absence of memorable co-occurrences. To understand this point, think about what we call the great fourfold table of life. Many scenarios in everyday life can be arranged in a fourfold table. For example, let's investigate the question of whether full moons are associated with more admissions to psychiatric hospitals, as emergency room physicians and nurses commonly claim in myth number 42. To answer this question, we need to establish and examine all four cells of the great fourfold table of life. Cell A, which consists of instances when there's a full moon and a psychiatric hospital admission. Cell B, which consists of instances when there's a full moon but no psychiatric hospital admission. Cell C, which consists of instances when there's no full moon and a psychiatric hospital admission. And cell D, which consists of instances when there's no full moon and no psychiatric hospital admission. Using all four cells allows you to compute the correlation between full moons and the number of psychiatric hospital admissions. A correlation is a statistical measure of how closely these two variables are associated. By the way, a variable is a fancy term for anything that varies, like height, hair color, IQ, or extroversion. Here's the problem. In real life, we're often remarkably poor at estimating correlations from the great fourfold table of life because we generally pay too much attention to certain cells and not enough to others. In particular, research demonstrates that we typically pay too much attention to the A cell, instances where there's a full moon and a psychiatric hospital admission, and not nearly enough to the B cell, when there's a full moon but no psychiatric hospital admission. After all, when there's a full moon and a lot of people end up in a psychiatric hospital, it confirms our initial expectations, so we tend to notice it, remember it, and tell others about it. The A cell is a hit, a striking co-occurrence. But when there's a full moon and nobody ends up in a psychiatric hospital, we barely notice or remember this non-event. Nor are we likely to run excitedly to our friends and tell them, "Wow, there was a full moon tonight, and guess what happened? Nothing." The B cell is a miss, the absence of a striking co-occurrence. Our tendency to remember our hits and forget our misses often leads to a remarkable phenomenon called illusory correlation, the mistaken perception that two statistically unrelated events are actually related. The supposed relation between full moons and psychiatric hospital admissions is a stunning example of an illusory correlation. Although many people are convinced that this correlation exists, research demonstrates that it doesn't. The belief in the full moon effect is a cognitive illusion. Illusory correlations can lead us to see a variety of associations that aren't there. For example, many people with arthritis insist that their joints hurt more in rainy than in non-rainy weather. Yet studies demonstrate that this association is a figment of their imaginations. Presumably, people with arthritis attend too much to the A cell of their great fourfold table of life. Instances when it rains and when their joints hurt, leading them to perceive a correlation that doesn't exist. Similarly, the early phrenologists saw close linkages between damage to specific brain areas and deficits in certain psychological abilities, but they were wildly wrong. Another probable example of illusory correlation is the perception that cases of infantile autism, a severe psychiatric disorder marked by severe language and social deficits, are associated with prior exposure to mercury-based vaccines, myth 41. Numerous carefully conducted studies have found no association whatsoever between the incidence of infantile autism and mercury vaccine exposure, although tens of thousands of parents of autistic children are convinced otherwise. In all probability, these parents are paying too much attention to the A cell of the fourfold table. They can hardly be blamed for doing so, given that they're understandably trying to detect an event, such as a vaccination, that could explain their children's autism. Moreover, these parents may have been fooled by the fact that the initial appearance of autistic symptoms, often shortly after age 2, often coincides at the age when most children receive vaccinations. 4. Inferring causation from correlation. It's tempting, but incorrect, to conclude that if two things co-occur statistically, that is, if two things are correlated, then they must be causally related to each other. As psychologists like to say, correlation doesn't mean causation. So, if variables A and B are correlated, there can be three major explanations for this correlation. 1. A may cause B. 2. B may cause A. Or 3. A third variable, C, may cause both A and B. This last scenario is known as the third variable problem because C is a third variable that may contribute to the association between variables A and Z. The problem is that the researchers who conducted the study may never have measured C. In fact, they may have never known about C's existence. Let's take a concrete example. Numerous studies demonstrate that a history of physical abuse in childhood increases one's odds of becoming an aggressive person in adulthood. Many investigators have interpreted this statistical association as implying that childhood physical abuse causes physical aggression in later life. Indeed, this interpretation is called the cycle of violence hypothesis. In this case, the investigators are assuming that childhood physical abuse, A, causes adult violence. Is this explanation necessarily right? Of course, in this case, B can't cause A because B occurred after A. A basic principle of logic is that causes must precede their effects. Yet, we haven't ruled out the possibility that a third variable, C, explains both A and B. One potential third variable in this case is a genetic tendency toward aggressiveness. Perhaps most parents who physically abuse their children harbor a genetic tendency toward aggressiveness, which they pass on to their children. Indeed, there's good research evidence that aggressiveness is partly influenced by genes. This genetic tendency, C, could result in a correlation between childhood physical abuse history, A, and later aggression in individuals with this history, B, even though A and B may be causally unrelated to each other. Incidentally, there are other potential candidates for C in this case. Can you think of any? The key point is that when two variables are correlated, we shouldn't necessarily assume a direct causal relationship between them. Competing explanations are possible. 5. Post hoc ergo prompter hoc reasoning. Post hoc ergo prompter hoc means after this, therefore because of this in Latin. Many of us leap to the conclusion that because A precedes B, then A must cause B. But many events that occur before other events don't cause them. For example, the fact that virtually all serial killers ate cereal as children doesn't mean that eating cereal produces serial killers, or even cereal with a C killers. We couldn't resist the pun, in adulthood. Or the fact that some people become less depressed soon after taking an herbal remedy doesn't mean that the herbal remedy caused or even contributed to their improvement. These people might have become less depressed even without the herbal remedy, or they might have sought out other effective interventions, like talking to a therapist or even to a supportive friend at about the same time. Or perhaps taking the herbal remedy inspired a sense of hope in them, resulting in what psychologists call a placebo effect, improvement resulting from the mere expectation of improvement. Even trained scientists can fall prey to post-hoc ergo prompter-hoc reasoning. In the Journal of Medical Hypotheses, Flensmark in 2004 observed that the appearance of shoes in the Western world about 1,000 years ago was soon followed by the first appearance of cases of schizophrenia. From these findings, he proposed that shoes play a role in triggering schizophrenia. But the appearance of shoes could have merely coincided with other changes, such as the growth of modernization or an increase in stressful living conditions, which may have contributed more directly to the emergence of schizophrenia. 6. Exposure to a biased sample. In the media and many aspects of daily life, we're often exposed to a non-random, or what psychologists called a biased, sample of people from the general population. For example, television programs portray approximately 75% of severely mentally ill individuals as violent, although the actual rate of violence among the severely mentally ill is considerably lower than that, as we'll hear in myth number 43. Such skewed media coverage may fuel the erroneous impression that most individuals with schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, once called manic depression, and other serious mental illnesses are physically dangerous. Psychotherapists may be especially prone to this error because they spend most of their working lives with an unrepresentative group of individuals, namely, people in psychological treatment. Here's an example. Many psychotherapists believe it's exceedingly difficult for people to quit smoking on their own. Yet, research demonstrates that many, if not most, smokers manage to stop without formal psychological treatment. These psychotherapists are probably falling prey to what statisticians Patricia and Jacob Cohen in 1984 termed the clinician's illusion, the tendency for practitioners to overestimate how chronic, long-standing, a psychological problem is because of their selective exposure to a chronic sample. That is, because clinicians who treat cigarette smokers tend to see only those individuals who can't stop smoking on their own, otherwise these smokers presumably wouldn't have sought out a clinician in the first place, these clinicians tend to overestimate how difficult smokers find it to quit without treatment. 7. Reasoning by representativeness. We often evaluate the similarity between two things on the basis of their superficial resemblance to each other. Psychologists call this phenomenon the representativeness heuristic because we use the extent to which two things are representative of each other to estimate how similar they are. A heuristic, by the way, is a mental shortcut or rule of thumb. Most of the time, the representativeness heuristic, like other heuristics, serves us well. If we're walking down the street and see a masked man running out of a bank with a gun, we'll probably try to get out of the way as quickly as we can. That's because this man is representative of, similar to, bank robbers we've seen on television and in motion pictures. Of course, it's possible that he's just pulling a prank or that he's an actor in a Hollywood action movie being filmed there, but better safe than sorry. In this case, we relied on a mental shortcut, and we were probably smart to do so. Yet we sometimes apply the representative heuristic when we shouldn't. Not all things that resemble each other superficially are related to each other, so the representative heuristic sometimes leads us astray. In this case, common sense is correct. We can't always judge a book by its cover. Indeed, many psychological myths probably arise from a misapplication of representativeness. For example, some graphologists, handwriting analysts, claim that people whose handwriting contains many widely spaced letters possess strong needs for interpersonal distance, or that people who cross their T's and F's with whip-like lines tend to be sadistic. In this case, graphologists are assuming that two things that superficially resemble each other, like widely spaced letters and a need for interpersonal space, are statistically associated. Yet there's not a shred of research support for these claims. Another example comes from human figure drawings, which many clinical psychologists use to detect respondents' personality traits and psychological disorders. Human figure drawing tasks, like the ever-popular draw a person test, ask people to draw a person, or in some cases two persons of opposite sexes, in any way they wish. Some clinicians who use these tests claim that respondents who draw people with large eyes are paranoid, that respondents who draw people with large heads are narcissistic, self-centered, and even that respondents who draw people with long ties are excessively preoccupied with sex. A long tie is a favorite Freudian symbol for the male sexual organ. All these claims are based on a surface resemblance between specific human figure drawing signs and specific psychological characteristics. Yet, research offers no support for these supposed associations. 8. Misleading film and media portrayals. Many psychological phenomena, especially mental illnesses and treatments for them, are frequently portrayed inaccurately in the entertainment and news media. More often than not, the media depicts these phenomena as more sensational than they are. For example, some modern films picture electroconvulsive therapy, ECT, known informally as shock therapy, as a physically brutal and even dangerous treatment. In some cases, as in the 1999 horror film House on Haunted Hill, individuals who are strapped to ECT machines in movies experience violent convulsions. Although it's true that ECT was once somewhat dangerous, technological advances over the past few decades, such as the administration of a muscle relaxant, have rendered it no more physically hazardous than anesthesia. Moreover, patients who receive modern forms of ECT don't experience observable motor convulsions. Take another example. Most Hollywood films depict adults with autism as possessing highly specialized intellectual skills. In the 1988 Academy Award-winning film Rain Man, Dustin Hoffman portrayed an autistic adult with savant syndrome. This syndrome is characterized by remarkable mental abilities, such as calendar calculation, the ability to name the day of a week given any year and date, multiplication and division of extremely large numbers, and knowledge of trivia, such as the batting averages of all active Major League Baseball players. Yet, at most, 10% of autistic adults are savants. 9. Exaggeration of a kernel of truth. Some psychological myths aren't entirely false. Instead, they're exaggerations of claims that contain a kernel of truth. For example, it's almost certainly true that many of us don't realize our full intellectual potential. Yet this fact doesn't mean that most of us use only 10% of our brain power, as many people incorrectly believe. We'll hear about that in myth number 1. In addition, it's probably true that at least a few differences in interests and personality traits between romantic partners can spice up a relationship. That's because sharing your life with someone who agrees with you on everything can make your love life harmonious, but hopelessly boring. Yet this fact doesn't imply that opposites attract, which we'll take a look at in myth 27. Still other myths involve an overstatement of small differences. For example, although men and women tend to differ slightly in their communication styles, some popular psychologists, especially John Gray, have taken this kernel of truth to an extreme, claiming that men are from Mars and women are from Venus. Myth number 29. 10. Terminological confusion. Some psychological terms lend themselves to mistaken inferences. For example, the word schizophrenia, which Swiss psychiatrist Eugene Bleuler coined in the early 20th century, literally means split mind. As a consequence, many people believe incorrectly that people with schizophrenia possess more than one personality, as we'll see in myth number 39. Indeed, we'll frequently hear the term schizophrenic in everyday language to refer to instances in which a person is of two different minds about an issue. I'm feeling very schizophrenic about my girlfriend. I'm attracted to her physically, but bothered by her personality quirks. It's therefore hardly surprising that many people confuse schizophrenia with an entirely different condition called multiple personality disorder, known today as dissociative identity disorder, which is supposedly characterized by the presence of more than one personality within the same individual. In fact, schizophrenics possess only one personality that's been shattered. Indeed, Bleuler in 1911 intended the term schizophrenia to refer to the fact that individuals with this condition suffer from a splitting of mental functions, such as thinking and emotion, whereby their thoughts don't correspond to their feelings. Nevertheless, in the world of popular psychology, Bleuler's original and more accurate meaning has largely been lost. The misleading stereotype of schizophrenics as persons who act like two completely different people on different occasions has become ingrained in modern culture. To take another example, the term hypnosis derives from the Greek prefix hypno, which means sleep. Indeed, some early hypnotists believed that hypnosis was a form of sleep. This term may have led many people, including some psychologists, to assume that hypnosis is a sleep-like state. In films, hypnotists often attempt to induce a hypnotic state by telling their clients that you're getting sleepy. Yet in fact, hypnosis bears no physiological relationship to sleep, because people who are hypnotized remain entirely awake and fully aware of their surroundings, as we'll hear in Myth 19. The world of psychomythology. What lies ahead? In this audiobook, you'll encounter 50 myths that are commonplace in the world of popular psychology. These myths span much of the broad landscape of modern psychology. Brain functioning, perception, development, memory, intelligence, learning, altered states of consciousness, emotion, interpersonal behavior, personality, mental illness, the courtroom, and psychotherapy. You'll learn about the psychological and societal origins of each myth, discover how each myth has shaped society's popular thinking about human behavior, and find out what scientific research has to say about each myth. At the end of each chapter, we'll provide you with a list of additional psychological myths to explore in each domain. In the book's postscript, we'll offer a list of fascinating findings that may appear to be fictional, but that are actually factual, to remind you that genuine psychology is often even more remarkable and difficult to believe than psychomythology. Debunking myths comes with its share of risks. Psychologist Norbert Schwartz and his colleagues showed that correcting a misconception, such as the side effects of a flu vaccine are often worse than the flu itself, can sometimes backfire by leading people to be more likely to believe this misconception later. That's because people often remember the statement itself, but not its negation tag. That is, the little yellow sticky note in our heads that says, this claim is wrong. Schwartz's work reminds us that merely memorizing a list of misconceptions isn't enough. It's crucial to understand the reasons underlying each misconception. His work also suggests that it's essential for us to understand not merely what's false, but also what's true. Linking up a misconception with the truth is the best means of debunking that misconception. That's why we'll spend some time explaining not only why each of these 50 myths is wrong, but also how each of these 50 myths imparts an underlying truth about psychology. Fortunately, there's at least some reason to be optimistic. Research shows that psychology students' acceptance of psychological misconceptions like people use only 10% of their brain's capacity declines with the total number of psychology classes they've taken. This same study also showed that acceptance of these misconceptions is lower among psychology majors than non-majors. Although such research is only correlational, we've already learned that correlation doesn't always mean causation. It gives us at least a glimmer of hope that education can reduce people's beliefs in psychomythology. What's more, recent controlled research suggests that explicitly refuting psychological misconceptions in introductory psychology lectures or readings can lead to large, up to 53.7% decreases in the levels of these misconceptions. If we've succeeded in our mission, you should emerge from this audiobook not only with a higher psychology IQ, but also a better understanding of how to distinguish fact from fiction in popular psychology. Perhaps most important, you should emerge with the critical thinking tools needed to better evaluate psychological claims in everyday life. As the paleontologist and science writer Stephen Jay Gould in 1996 pointed out, the most erroneous stories are those we think we know best and therefore never scrutinize or question. Page 57. In this audiobook, we'll encourage you to never accept psychological stories on faith alone and to always scrutinize and question the psychological stories you think you know best. There are numerous references for the many statements of fact made throughout this audio program. To see the complete list, please consult our reference list available in the companion PDF to this audiobook. So, without further ado, let's enter the surprising and often fascinating world of psychomythology. Chapter 1. Brain Power. Myths about the brain and perception. Myth number 1. Most people use only 10% of their brain power. Whenever those of us who study the brain venture out of the ivory tower to give public lectures or media interviews, one of the questions we're most likely to encounter is it true that we use only 10% of our brains? The look of disappointment that usually follows when we respond, "Sorry, I'm afraid not," strongly suggests that the 10% myth is one of those hopeful truisms that refuses to die simply because it would be so darn nice if it were true. Indeed, this myth is widespread, even among psychology students and other well-educated people. In one study, when asked, "About what percentage of their potential brain power do you think most people use?" a third of psychology majors answered 10%. 59% of a sample of college-educated people in Brazil similarly believe that people use only 10% of their brains. Remarkably, that same survey revealed that even 6% of neuroscientists agreed with this claim. Surely none of us would turn down a hefty hike in brain power if we could achieve it. Not surprisingly, marketers who thrive on the public's fond hopes for a self-improvement breakthrough continue to peddle a never-ending stream of dubious schemes and devices premised on the 10% myth. Always on the lookout for a feel-good story, the media has played a big role in keeping this optimistic myth alive. A great deal of advertising copy for legitimate products continues to refer to the 10% myth as fact, usually in the hopes of flattering potential customers who see themselves as having risen above their brain's limitations. For example, in his popular book, How to Be Twice as Smart, Scott Witt in 1983 wrote that, "If you're like most people, you're using only 10% of your brain power." Page 4. In 1999, an airline tried to entice potential flyers by informing them that, "It's been said that we use only 10% of our brain capacity. If, however, you're flying," name of company deleted, "airlines, you're using considerably more." Yet an expert panel convened by the U.S. National Research Council concluded that, alas, in this, as with other miraculous self-improvement claims, there's no good substitute for hard work when it comes to getting ahead in life. This unwelcome news has done little to discourage millions who comfort themselves with the belief that the shortcut to their unfulfilled dreams lies in the fact that they just haven't quite caught up with the secret for tapping their vast, allegedly unused cerebral reservoir. That desired promotion, stellar grade point average, or authorship of the next best-selling novel is within your grasp, say the sellers of cerebral miracle remedies. Even more questionable are the offerings of new-age entrepreneurs who propose to hone the psychic skills we allegedly all possess with obscure gizmos for the brain. Self-proclaimed psychic Uri Geller, in 1996, claimed that, "In fact, most of us use only about 10% of our brains, if that." Promoters like Geller imply that psychic powers reside in the 90% of the brain that simple folk forced to subsist on the drudge-like 10% haven't yet learned to use. Why would a brain researcher doubt that 90% of the average brain lies silent? There are several reasons. First of all, our brain has been shaped by natural selection. Brain tissue is expensive to grow and operate. At a mere 2 to 3% of our body weight, it consumes over 20% of the oxygen we breathe. It's implausible that evolution would have permitted the squandering of resources on a scale necessary to build and maintain such a massively underutilized organ. Moreover, if having a bigger brain contributes to the flexibility that promotes survival and reproduction, which are natural selection's bottom lines, it's hard to believe that any slight increase in processing power wouldn't be snapped up immediately by existing systems in the brain to enhance the bearer's chances in the continuous struggle to prosper and procreate. Doubts about the 10% figure are also fueled by evidence from clinical neurology and neuropsychology, two disciplines that aim to understand and alleviate the effects of brain damage. Losing far less than 90% of the brain to accident or disease almost always has catastrophic consequences. Look, for instance, at the much-publicized controversy surrounding the non-conscious status and ultimate death of Terry Schiavo, the young Florida woman who lay in a persistent vegetative state for 15 years. Oxygen deprivation following a cardiac arrest in 1990 had destroyed about 50% of her cerebrum, the upper part of the brain responsible for conscious awareness. Modern brain science argues that mind equals brain function. Therefore, patients like Ms. Shivo had permanently lost the capacity for thoughts, perceptions, memories, and emotions that are the very essence of being human. Although some claimed to see signs of consciousness in Shivo, most impartial experts found no evidence that any of her higher mental processes had been spared. If 90% of the brain is indeed unnecessary, this shouldn't have been the case. Research also reveals that no area of the brain can be destroyed by strokes or head trauma without leaving patients with serious deficits in functioning. Likewise, electrical stimulation of sites in the brain during neurosurgery has failed to uncover any silent areas, those in which the person experiences no perception, emotion, or movement after neurosurgeons apply these tiny currents. Neurosurgeons can accomplish this feat with conscious patients under local anesthesia because the brain contains no pain receptors. The last century has witnessed the advent of increasingly sophisticated technologies for snooping on the brain's traffic. With the aid of brain imaging techniques, such as electroencephalograms, EEGs, positron emission tomography, PET, or PET scanners, and functional magnetic resonance imaging, MRI machines, researchers have succeeded in localizing a vast number of psychological functions to specific brain areas. With non-human animals, and occasionally with humans undergoing neurological treatment, researchers can insert recording probes into the brain. Despite this detailed mapping, no quiet areas awaiting new assignments have emerged. In fact, even simple tasks generally require contributions of processing areas spread throughout virtually the whole brain. Two other firmly established principles of neuroscience create further problems for the 10% myth. Areas of the brain that are unused because of injuries or disease tend to do one of two things. They either wither away, or degenerate, as neuroscientists put it, or they're taken over by nearby areas that are on the lookout for unused territory to colonize for their own purposes. Either way, perfectly good, unused brain tissue is unlikely to remain on the sidelines for long. All told, evidence suggests that there's no cerebral spare tire waiting to be mounted with a little help from the self-improvement industry. So, if the 10% myth is so poorly supported, how did it get started? Attempts to track down this myth's origins haven't uncovered any smoking guns, but a few tantalizing clues have materialized. One stream leads back to pioneering American psychologist William James in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. In one of his writings for the general public, James said he doubted that average persons achieve much more than about 10% of their intellectual potential. James always talked in terms of underdeveloped potential, never relating it to a specific amount of the brain engaged.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.